This session is about handmade in India. India's handmade handcraft culture goes thousands of years ago and is buried in the hoary mists of history. Right from the Sindhu Saraswati civilization to the present day, we come across handcrafted material in such exquisite manners and in such diversity. And there is a certain a certain kind of approach to handcraft, because it is an approach of doing something with the divine. I mean, you go to the potter and you find him in a sort of a meditative mood when he's making his craft. And same with we have a gem palace here. I'm sure everybody has that experience. And of course, Mahatma Gandhi also made the whole art of weaving something as an inner journey. And it's wonderful to have all these panelists join us today. And I think I should, I actually have so much to tell you about Ambassador Srimati Suchitra Dure. She's our special guest. And since joining the Indian Foreign Service in 1988, Srimati Suchitra Dure has served in various capacities, both at headquarters and abroad. She has served as High Commissioner of India to Kenya, as India's ambassador to Somalia, and as a permanent representative of India to the UN offices in Nairobi from 2015 to 2018. From October 2015 to mid-2016, she also served as India's ambassador to Eritrea. Prior to this, she was the Director General dealing with Sri Lanka, Maldives, and the Indian Ocean region in the Ministry of External Affairs, New Delhi, from 2014 to 15. From 2012 to 14, she was Director General for Consular Affairs. Her earlier stints at the Government of India include that of Director and Acting Head of the Division in MEA, dealing with Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and Maldives. In 2007, Deputy Secretary and Head of the External Relations Division of the Department of Atomic Energy in Mumbai, from 1998 to 2001. Desk Officer for Disarmament and International Security Affairs in MEA from 1993 to 1996, and Desk Officer for Western Europe from 1992 to 1993. She has served abroad as Minister, Culture, and Director of the Indian Cultural Center at Cairo from 2009 to 12, as Counselor at Embassy of India in Vienna, and alternate to the Governor for India at the Board of Governors of the International Atomic Energy Agency from 2001 to 6, as First Secretary in the Embassy of India in Buenos Aires from 96 to 98, and as Third Secretary, Language Trainee, Second Secretary at the Embassy of India, Madrid from 90 to 92. This is a really colorful career, madam. We are so fortunate that you are here, and I hand it over to you to tell us a few words. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for those very kind words, Srimati Vijayalakshmi ji. I'm very honored to be invited by the Center for Soft Power in this very important and very topical Utsav that you are organizing of India's soft power. Now, since this entire celebration is actually scheduled around India's Independence Day, may I take this opportunity to also belatedly convey my greetings on the 74th Independence Day of India, as also, of course, on the National Handloom Day itself, which was celebrated on the 7th of August. Now, the term India's soft power, of course, is used very often, and most people are familiar with the concept. But this is actually, the term itself was used by Joseph Nye, of course, about two decades ago. And since then, there's a lot of discussion on what is soft power, what is hard power, and what is, in fact, smart power, which combines the two. Now, centuries, millennia, as you rightly said, before such a term got invented, India's soft power was all pervasive in the region that I'm currently in, that is Southeast Asia. And it is particularly evident in Thailand, which is really at the center, at the heart of Southeast Asia. Now, if you merely look at the names of people, of most Thais, they're all actually inspired by Sanskrit. It was very interesting for me to be posted in Thailand, because earlier, wherever I was posted, my name, although it's very common in India, would be difficult for most people to pronounce, but not in Thailand, because in Thailand, there are any number of Suchitras of my generation. And in fact, they consider it a Thai name. That shows the extent of India's, influence, cultural influence in this part of the world. Every street that you go through almost has a shrine to Lord Ganesha. The emblem of the Municipal Corporation of Bangkok, for example, is actually Lord Indra on the Airavat. The ancient kingdom of this country, Ayodhya, was named after, of course, Lord Rama's kingdom of Ayodhya. And all the kings of the present, the ruling Chakri dynasty, they have the title of Rama, which is, of course, from Lord Ram. So that shows, in fact, the great influence of India over this part of the world, particularly in Thailand. The dominant religion, of course, is Buddhism, which came from India. But underlying that is a very strong layer of Hinduism, which is known as Brahmanism in Thailand. And mixes together in a very harmonic traditions of animism, of respect for ancestors, for spirit worship, and it all comes together in a very unique Thai way. Now, present day India's soft power is expressed in many ways, including, of course, in our prowess in science and technology, through our dominance in terms of pharmaceuticals, in the IT sector. So this is what India is known for now in a contemporary age. And also Bollywood has had its influence, not currently now. I think Korea is taken over India in this part of the world through its K-pop, etc. But people of a certain generation do still sing the songs of old Indian films, which continue to be popular. Also, television has a number of serials which are dubbed in the Thai language. And then coming to Thai language itself, the language, in fact, draws a lot on both Sanskrit as well as Pali. In addition, the script itself is the Pallava script, which just shows the kind of soft power influence that India has had in this part of the world through the ages. Now, you come to the topic of handmade in India. Now, the most, the item which most strikes you when you think of items which are handmade in India are the textiles. Since times immemorial, Indian textiles were famous. They dominated world trade. If you go to ancient Egypt or to Greece, you still see references to Indian textiles, which played such an important role in India's external trade at that point. Even Southeast Asia, the role of Indian textiles, in fact, is phenomenal. In fact, it was through trade that there was an exchange of ideas, of thought, of belief, and Buddhism, and perhaps Hinduism earlier, all came here through trading in all these handmade products. Even if you look at cuisine, for example, in present-day Thailand, in southern Thailand particularly, there's a lot of influence of many of the spices that we use in India, of the use of turmeric, which is widely prevalent there, certain kinds of dishes, including the Masaman curry, for example, which is a variation of the term Musalman, was brought in by Indian traders and through Arab and Persian influences in southern Thailand. Coming back to textiles, if you look at the Ayodhya kingdom, it was a very important trading kingdom. It was a regional power economically. but they imported a lot of textiles from India. Cotton textiles predominantly from the Coromandel coast. We used to have chintzes coming in from Masulipatnam, which is of course Machilipatnam currently in Andhra Pradesh. And also much later, you had a lot of material coming in from Gujarat. The double ikat, the patola of Gujarat, was shared with Thailand. And now Thai textiles use a lot of the same geometric design in their weaves. So this is the influence that India had down the ages in this part of the world. Now look at Ayurveda. The Thai massage, for example, which is so famous and which is a great attraction for most people who come here, draws a lot upon the old Ayurvedic massages. The whole concept of Buddhist meditation, which is also very important and has gone back to India in a way through the Vipassana techniques, also draw upon from India. So we have all these practices and all these products on which we have drawn from each other. When you look at, for example, the Swadeshi movement, you made a reference to it. Hand looms and handmade products are so intrinsic to the current Indian identity because they really got a revival in 1905 when in Bengal, the whole concept, the Swadeshi movement began. And this was later coalesced into Gandhiji's own Satyagraha movement. And as you rightly mentioned, the charkha, the khadi cloth, that became a byword for us. And the importance given to cottage industries also soon after India's independence has continued this particular tradition. So it is not only a rich aspect of our past, of our history, it's a very important aspect of our fight for freedom, for our revival of our ancient traditions, and as a very important aspect of our national identity. Currently, when you look at it, the importance given to the revival of handlooms is extremely important. It's part of course, our Atmanirbhar Bharat program, which was launched by Honorable Prime Minister. And if you look at the handloom sector itself, economically, it makes huge sense because after agriculture, I believe that handloom sector is one of the greatest employers. There are more than 10 million artisans working on this. And then each artisan would be supporting at least 4 to 5 members in every family. So you can see the multiplier effect of handmade objects. And also if you look at it in terms of climate change, it reduces the carbon footprint through the use of vegetable dyes, the lower use of fresh water in comparison to synthetic textiles. 83% of the people who are involved in the handloom sector are women. So it greatly, hugely contributes to women's empowerment. Particularly in the COVID-19 period, I think people have, you know, apart from many other aspects, the importance of using Indian textiles to project their national identity has come out in the fore. For example, all of us are using printed masks made in India, using khadi made masks. We're very proud of that. We try to give as much as we can gifts which showcase Indian handmade products. I have personally, I try to ensure that all the, the saris that I wear are representing different states of India because each of them have a very important tradition. The gifts that we give, everyday objects or decorative objects are all handmade and project India's great traditions. And in terms of trade also, we can greatly promote this. We are doing it through, of course, many of our companies are also now promoting Ayurvedic medicines here, which are quite popular in a country like Thailand, for example. Dabur's, many of the products are well known. Himalaya products are well known. So they have a great market here. Now, of course, one other aspect is, I think others are going to speak on it, but toys. I think, India has a huge, long-standing tradition of also making handmade toys. You have Chennapatna, very close to Bengaluru, which is so well known. Handmade toys are very important to develop your psychomotor skills. These toys are sturdy. They use non-toxic materials, and they're beautiful to look at. And I think there is a great market for such toys now all over the world. And we, of course, as Indian embassies, are doing a lot to promote what is handmade in India. However, when we look at it, I think all of soft power, it's not just a one-way street. It's a two-way process. We learn from the influences of other people, even as we give. And all of cultural diplomacy and cultural exchanges are really about exchanges and about mutual respect and mutual understanding. And even as we give, what can we learn from the others? So I'll just give you two examples from Thailand, which I think they've done brilliantly. They have something called the One Tambon, One Product Program, called the OTOP, which has become a huge success. It's a royally supported project. And it really focuses every district in the country, focuses on one particular product, which they do it with great perfection. And frequently there are markets and public fairs and festivals where the top leadership of the country comes in and people are encouraged to buy it. And many of the big, five-star hotels here try to actually use these OTOP products as part of their furnishings. So they take real great pride in what they produce in a handmade way. This, in fact, this OTOP idea was shared by our mission with the Honorable Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh when he had visited Thailand some time back. And now you have in UP itself, the ODOP program, which is one district, one product program. So that is, I think, one best practice which one can think of. The other thing is the way they have been promoting Thai silk. If you consider 250 years ago, actually most silk to Thailand came from India. Indian silks were famous. They continue to be very famous. They were used in the royal court by royalty. There were specific patterns. There were specific designs which was used for both ritual worship, and it continues to this day. However, over time, Thai has also now developed its silk. It's very well packaged, beautifully presented. And that is something that we could learn from the Thai side on, presentation, how to make a beautiful thing even more beautiful by the way it is packaged. So thank you very much. I wish the discussions all success. I think the flyer is beautiful. I just saw a coffee filter. This is what we use daily in our home in Chennai. And I use, of course, the stainless steel version, which is not as nice. But the brass one is the one which gives really the essence, which contributes to the aroma and the flavor. So I think what you're doing to revive all these old traditions and to package it and to promote it, not just within India, but all over the world, is a wonderful initiative. So thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, Ambassador Suchitra Dorai. Your opening address gives us a good impression of how peaceful relations with a neighboring country can be mutually beneficial, both spiritually as well as in terms of trade. Under the stewardship of Ambassador Suchitra Dorai, the Indian Embassy in Thailand has been doing wonderful work in the field of art and culture. We would like to showcase one video which was kindly shared by ICCR in Thailand. Kotiji, please could you share that?
नमस्कार मेरा नाम सुनहरी है मैं एसवीसीसी का छात्र हूँ आज मैं एक कविता पढ़ूंगी। कविता का नाम तू जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर है। प्लीज एंजॉय। तू जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर। तू जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर। सुंदर सपने की ताने बाने बल, सुंदर सपनों की ताने बाने बल, उसमें उलझने की कोशिश ना कर। चलते वक्त के साथ तू भी चल, चलते वक्त के साथ तू भी चल, उसमें सिमटने की कोशिश ना कर। अपने हाथ को फैला, अपने हाथ को फैला, खुलकर साथ ले। अपने हाथ को फैला, खुलकर साथ ले। अंडर ही अंडर घुटने की कोशिश ना कर। अंडर ही अंडर घुटने की कोशिश ना कर। मन में जल रहे युद्ध को विराम दे, मन में जल रहे युद्ध को विराम दे। खामख्वाह कुछ से लड़ने की कोशिश ना कर। खामख्वाह कुछ से लड़ने की कोशिश ना कर। तू जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर। तू जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर। कुछ बातें भगवान पलचो दे, कुछ बातें भगवान पलचो दे। सब कुछ कुछ सुलझाने की कोशिश ना कर। सब कुछ कुछ सुलझाने की कोशिश ना कर। जो मिल गया उसी में खुश रहे, जो मिल गया उसी में खुश रहे। जो सुकून जी ले वो पाने की कोशिश ना कर। जो सुकून जी ले वो पाने की कोशिश ना कर। रास्ते की सुंदरता का रूप था, रास्ते की सुंदरता का रूप था। मंजिल पर जल्दी पहुँचने की कोशिश ना कर। मंजिल पर जल्दी पहुँचने की कोशिश ना कर। तू जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर। तो जिंदगी को जी उसे समझने की कोशिश ना कर। धन्यवाद।